you've ever wanted to know what life as an introvert is like, you'll be finding out over the course of at least the next several weeks. Sports are postponed or canceled, concerts are gone for the moment, even sitting on the toilet to read a book and wipe your ass is impossible because people decided to buy out all the toilet paper. And to those of you hoarding shit tickets right now, you do realize that COVID-19 is a respiratory virus. That means it affects your lungs, not your colon. Anyway, it looks like we'll be stuck indoors for a while, so no doubt you'll be looking for some mindless entertainment. And my videos, while certainly mindless, are rather short. So maybe you're thinking about some movies to watch to pass the time. Let me help give some recommendations of what to avoid. Just like my worst song compilations, I'm not including amateur stuff or B-movies, and I'll only include flicks that I've actually seen in their entirety. So, with all that having been said, here it is, my list of the 10 worst movies of all time. Number 10 is Footloose. My mom was in love with this movie when I was a kid, so I saw it a number of times on TV growing up. Kevin Bacon was already a rising star in Hollywood, but Footloose was the film that rocketed his career to new heights in 1984. But his role as Ren McCormick, the city boy turned small town upstart, typecast him, and he found it rather difficult to find work for a few years because of that image. I don't know what's more amazing, the fact that Kevin Bacon was able to bounce back and have a successful career after starring in such a pile of shit like this, or the fact that the movie made $80 million in the US. And sure, by current standards, $80 million doesn't sound like a lot, but it was good enough for the 7th highest grossing film of 1984. Even Police Academy, the movie right above it on the list, has a more well-developed plot than Footloose. So the story here is that Kevin Bacon's character, Ren McCormick, is forced to move to a small town in Utah to live with his aunt and uncle. But Ren very quickly discovers that this town is apparently a theocracy where a preacher, played by John Lithgow, is in charge. There's a law that forbids people from listening to rock music and dancing. Yeah, I guess this town is somehow exempt from the First Amendment of the Constitution. So far, this sounds pretty awful. But as is the case with every 80s movie, there has to be a girl with a jealous, overprotective boyfriend that finds out you're the new guy in town who just so happened to say hello to his girlfriend and, oh boy, look out. Yeah, this movie has that as well. The boyfriend challenges Ren to a game of chicken involving tractors for some reason. The girl's father is John Lithgow's preacher character, as if we didn't see that coming. And you get the idea. You know what? It actually gets worse than this because, you see, Ren wants to overturn the ban on dancing. Because there's nothing men like to do more than to randomly dance, especially to the music of Kenny Loggins and Bonnie Tyler. If you told me tomorrow that dancing was illegal, my response would be, and? For this reason alone, this is easily the second dumbest plot line I've ever seen. You'll see what the worst is a little later. The acting is your typical 80s teenage cheese, nothing all that out of the ordinary for the genre. But to give you an idea of just how bad this movie is, the soundtrack is the best thing about it. Now, okay, that could be said for some good movies as well, but this is the soundtrack from Footloose. The aforementioned Kenny Loggins has not one, but two tracks here, including obviously Footloose and I'm Free, which is only slightly less hokey than Footloose. And there's Bonnie Tyler with Holding Out for a Hero. Mike Reno of Loverboy and Ann Wilson of Heart each team up to contribute the worst songs of their respective careers with Almost Paradise. Quiet Riot has a mediocre track called Metal Health. Even Quiet Riot fans will tell you that's not their best work. But it's not all bad. Foreigner and John Mellencamp make an appearance on the soundtrack. Objectively, most of these songs were big hits on Billboard, and this movie, as stated, was successful. But I challenge you, children of the late 70s and 80s, watch this movie now and tell me it's not garbage. And if you can, I'll tell you that you're a liar. Number 9 is Batman and Robin. The first two movies in the Batman franchise were 1989's Batman and the 1992 sequel, Batman Returns. Both movies featured Tim Burton as the director and Michael Keaton as Batman. They were both well-written, produced, and performed, and highly critically acclaimed. Batman Forever, which came out in 1995, was a bit of a different direction. Val Kilmer had the leading role, and the movie was produced by Joel Schumacher. Tim Burton was still a producer along with Peter McGregor Scott, but despite the changes behind the scenes, the movie was still decent. The acting was all right, script seemed good enough, I guess. Certainly a step in the wrong direction, but overall, still adequate. But in 1997, with Tim Burton completely out of the picture and Joel Schumacher at the helm, The clock was turned back about 30 years and we got Batman and Robin. George Clooney is a good actor, but even he couldn't salvage the terrible script in his portrayal of Batman. Somebody actually thought that a movie centered around a character whose parents are murdered in an alley and grows up to be a vigilante needs to have corny dialogue and cartoonish-style villains like Arnold Schwarzenegger's Mr. Freeze. Now, I'll admit, every time I pass by this movie while flipping through channels, I'll stop for a minute or two just to hear one of those horrendous icy puns that Mr. Freeze has. Like, "You're not sending me to the cooler," or "Stay cool, bald boy," and of course, "Alright everyone, chill." The storyline is so linear it hurts. Mr. Freeze is a scientist turned bad guy. He steals stuff. He'll freeze Gotham City and the world. Batman and Robin have to stop him. There's some added conflict, but it really doesn't matter. Some terrible fight scenes are in the mix. Spoiler alert, Batman wins, movie over. This movie had a ton of big names in it aside from just Clooney and Arnold. There was Chris O'Donnell, Alicia Silverstone, Uma Thurman, Vivica A. Fox. I mean, with that cast, how could you possibly fuck up that badly? And while it's certainly easy to blame Joel Schumacher for this debacle, it isn't all his fault. Warner Brothers wanted to ride the wave of success from Batman Forever, so they rushed the film's production schedule, and it shows. Even the critics widely agreed that the movie sucked. Despite a good opening weekend at the box office, the film only made $107 million domestically. And that ranks it as the lowest-grossing live-action Batman movie to date. At number 8, it's The Avengers. No, not that Avengers. Many of you won't remember this box office bomb from 1998, but sadly, I was one of the few people that saw it. In the theater. During the mid to late 90s, movie studios started getting all nostalgic for some of the old series. So the Bond films came back into popularity, Mission Impossible was brought back, so Warner Brothers decided to capitalize on this trend by reviving The Avengers, which was a popular British spy series from the 60s. Perhaps a bit obscure to American audiences, as it never really had quite the same appeal here in the US. Besides, Warner would never bring back an idea from the 60s that wasn't successful, right? Oh yeah, I just talked about that one. Well, anyway, this one stars Uma Thurman. Yeah, I know, another terrible movie with Uma Thurman, but just like with Batman and Robin, this really isn't her fault. Trust me. Sean Connery plays the role of Sir August de Winter, a mad scientist bent on controlling the world's weather, and goddammit, it's the same fucking premise as Batman and Robin. Okay, there are a few key differences, like, for instance, everyone in Sean Connery's evil organization, including Connery himself, dresses in teddy bear outfits, for some asinine reason. Connery wants the leaders of the world to buy weather from him, and if they don't, he'll make it rain chaos everywhere, or something. Whatever, stupid premise, bad execution, and you can see why this film only took in $48 million, which might not have been so bad, but it cost $60 million to produce. Number 7 is The Happening. M. Night Shyamalan reminds me of a person that walks up to a slot machine for the first time in their life, puts in 20 bucks, and on their first or second spin, hits the jackpot. A pretty sizable one at that. And in this case, that jackpot was The Sixth Sense. It was a really good movie, great performances, did well at the box office, got M. Night Shyamalan on the map. And yes, I know he directed Wide Awake before this, and he wrote She's All That, but The Sixth Sense was his career highlight. In the year 2000, he wrote and directed Unbreakable, and while it wasn't quite as successful or acclaimed as The Sixth Sense, it was still a solid movie. He then went on to write and direct Signs, The Village, and Lady in the Water, which were not very good, terrible, and mind-numbingly boring, respectively. Still, I'd rather watch any of those over The Happening. Now, the concept for The Happening is pretty original. Stupid as fuck, but original, I'll give it that. The trees are pissed off, and they emit some kind of airborne toxin that makes everyone want to commit gruesome suicide. At first, people don't know what's causing it. Maybe it's some type of terrorism or biological weapon, but it's revealed pretty quickly that it's the trees. Even Mark Wahlberg, who starred in this movie, admits that it was terrible, and that pretty much says it all. I mean, I could go into how stupid this movie really is. Like, for instance, when the trees are emitting their toxin, there's really nothing to show the audience to help dramatize this feature. But Shyamalan has a workaround for this. See, every time the trees put out their poison, the wind starts to blow really hard. I guess the trees control the weather? Maybe you're noticing a subtle theme to these terrible movies. Also, while fleeing from the toxic trees, some of the characters are driving in a car with the windows rolled down, as if that makes any sense. Basically, at the end of the movie, and with so many dead, the message here is that we have to respect Mother Nature, because if we don't, she might just go all Casey Anthony on us at any time. At number 6, it's Independence Day, Resurgence. Yes, Independence Day had a sequel. It grossed almost $400 million somehow. The first Independence Day, for most people, was a good film, from the standpoint of having action, explosions, death, a couple funny lines, just kind of a fun, turn-your-brain-off kind of flick. Unfortunately, for me, I kind of like a good story. Sure, I can suspend disbelief, but not to the point where Jeff Goldblum can conquer a race of beings that have mastered interstellar travel with a mid-1990s Toshiba laptop. Nor can I accept Will Smith masterfully piloting alien technology. Given everything that's going on right now, the idea that humans could beat a group of aliens when our society is being brought to its knees because of a virus that's infected less than 0.01% of the population is laughable. If aliens really wanted to conquer us, they'd just steal the world's supply of toilet paper. But anyway, putting that aside, the first Independence Day isn't good, so you can only imagine the sequel. The premise is simple. Just as we defeated the aliens at the end of the first movie, they sent out a distress call, and 20 years later, the mothership arrives. And boy, are they pissed. If this movie was more explosions and death and some of the same shit that we saw from the first movie, I could probably give it a pass. But instead, we're treated to a lot of pointless backstory about characters we couldn't care less about. No Will Smith, no interest, basically. They do make a rather unceremonious reference to the fact that Will Smith's character died during a test pilot mission. What, he can fly alien technology, but just during a routine test piloting mission he dies? Okay. Anyway, another kind of spoiler alert here. In the end, they leave room for yet another Independence Day. Yuck. Number 5 is Speed 2, Cruise Control. Just like with Independence Day, the first Speed movie was action-packed and fast-moving, but had a really stupid premise. A city bus that not only has to achieve 50 miles per hour through Los Angeles, but then needs to maintain that speed or a bomb would explode? Yeah, and as if that weren't enough, Keanu Reeves gives us the single worst-delivered line in the history of cinema with, "There is enough C4 here to blow a hole in the world." So it's hard to imagine making another movie like this and having it be anything but a total abomination. And that's exactly what happens. Imagine the action and tempo of the first Speed movie. Now, completely remove it and change the setting from a bus to a cruise ship. Now, add in the leading roles of Jason Patrick and Sandra Bullock as the protagonist couple, and Willem Dafoe as the former cruise ship employee turned terrorist hell-bent on crashing the ship into an oil tanker for revenge, and that sounds pretty shitty. Yeah, well, then there's the acting. Sandra Bullock isn't even trying in this movie, and it shows because her chemistry with Patrick is just non-existent. Meanwhile, Dafoe is cartoonishly over the top and frustratingly unrealistic in his dialogue. Actually, why am I even giving this a serious critique? The movie has the single worst scene of any movie on this list near the end of the film when the ship crashes into the marina of St. Martin and goes about a mile inland. What in the physics-defying fuck is up with that? Number 4 is Armageddon. How could you possibly go wrong with a cast that features Bruce Willis, Billy Bob Thornton, Ben Affleck, Liv Tyler, Steve Buscemi, Owen Wilson, and Michael Clark Duncan? It's easy. You have the single dumbest plot ever written with equally loathsome execution. This was the second summer blockbuster of 1998 to feature an asteroid headed for Earth. Unlike its predecessor, Deep Impact, the idea behind this movie was to send a crew to the asteroid, drill a hole into it, plant a nuke in its core, detonate it, and throw the asteroid safely off course. Obviously, with the world at stake, they'd get the best and the brightest of astronauts to do this task, right? No, because you see, it's apparently easier to train a group of oil drillers to become astronauts than it is to train astronauts to drill into an asteroid. Oh, but they must have had years to prepare them knowing that the asteroid was coming, right? Nope, apparently you can learn everything you need to know about being an astronaut in just 12 days. Name a dumber concept for a movie. I challenge you. There are worse movies, sure, but a more poorly designed plot? Not a fucking chance. By the way, one of the worst songs of 1998 comes from this film as well. You know what I'm talking about. Yep, that's the one. Number 3 is 2012. I love science fiction, and as I mentioned earlier, I'm willing to go pretty far to suspend disbelief. But in order for this movie to work, you pretty much have to abandon the laws of science completely. But don't take my word for it. NASA described this movie as the most absurd science fiction film ever. And that's a pretty bold statement considering that Lawnmower Man and Battlefield Earth were a thing. The story here is that neutrinos from the sun are disrupting the core of our planet and causing tectonic plates to shift and heave, so there's earthquakes and lava spewing up all over. The weather goes insane, and somehow these neutrinos aren't killing humans directly, but only the core of the Earth. Anyway, there's a scene where a vehicle is being chased by an opening chasm, which is pretty much the last straw of stupidity in this flick. Despite all of this, the film was still a blockbuster, making almost $770 million worldwide. Number 2 is San Andreas. If you care about special effects, things blowing up, and senseless mayhem, then this movie delivers. I get it, it's an action movie. It's not supposed to be cinematic art. And I guess I could have been okay with it, but for the fact that it's just so goddamn stupid. Sorry that I actually want at least a marginally believable story. Disaster, action movie, or otherwise. The first issue here, of which I laughed out loud when I saw it, was that The Rock was 43 years old when this movie was shot. The woman that plays his daughter is Alexandra Daddario, who was 29 years old. That means Dwayne would have had to been about 13 or 14 when he knocked some girl up. Damn, what a player. And if that was the only flaw this film had, I probably would have been able to overlook it. The Rock plays an LA emergency response worker, but apparently decides he needs to steal a helicopter in the middle of a disaster, which is pretty despicable. I wonder how many people would die as a result of that decision. They incorrectly refer to names of streets in San Francisco, such as Lombard Avenue, when it's actually Lombard Street, but that's just more nitpicky stuff, I suppose. By far the worst part is when The Rock swims underwater for about 10 straight minutes. I mean, he does a lot of other crazy feats of strength and maneuvers, but that one is where I had enough and just couldn't wait for this piece of crap to end. Alright, now before I reveal the worst movie of all time, here's some other notable dishonorable mentions. These are movies that were bad, but I just couldn't quite put them on the list. Such as Sex and the City 2. Okay, so the year was 2010. I was depressed and would spend hours on the couch watching whatever channel I happened to land on. Apathy took over and I couldn't even be bothered to change the channel for long periods of time. As a result, I saw some things that I can't unsee, such as Sex and the City 2. I don't remember all of it, and that's why I didn't put it on the list, but what I do remember was putrid. I hated the show, I never saw the first movie, and in all fairness, it's a show that's really not geared for people of my age group or gender. I think it's pretty telling how bad the movie was when Sarah Jessica Parker spends more time in an interview talking about how beautiful it was to be in Morocco, where the film was shot, rather than the movie itself. Next up, it's Mac and Me. Did you ever wonder what E.T. would have been like if it was a low-budget film starring a child that's confined to a wheelchair but cleverly disguised as a Coca-Cola and McDonald's commercial? Well, if so, then feel free to check out Mac and Me. Yes, I saw this copycat crap in the theater with a friend. 10-year-olds usually don't have much of a discerning taste when it comes to movies, but my friend fell asleep from boredom while I just kept checking my watch and looking forward to attending my aunt's funeral later that night. I wish that was a joke, but yes, the funeral was actually the highlight of the day. And finally, we have The Visit. Oh look, another M. Night Shyamalan piece of shit. I only put this as a dishonorable mention because I didn't actually get through the whole movie. It was dreadfully boring, even more so than Lady in the Water. Basically, this movie is visual Ambien. Alright, and now it's time to reveal the worst movie of all time, The Killing of a Sacred Deer. Colin Farrell and Nicole Kidman are pretty respectable names in Hollywood. Maybe not A-listers, but certainly not the kind of people that you would associate with an artsy, experimental, college film student horror flick like this bag of feces. It's the story of the perfect nuclear family. Farrell and Kidman play as Stephen and Anna Murphy. Stephen is a heart surgeon, Anna is a doctor of some kind. but her part is basically superfluous to the story. They have two children, Bob and Kim. The very first thing you'll notice about this movie is that everyone speaks with a very strange cadence, almost as if it's their first time reading through the script. Some lines are delivered with absolutely zero enthusiasm, while others are corny and over the top. And this goes through the whole fucking movie. I know some people think this is a charming characteristic, but nobody talks like that. The other obvious irritant is the music. A strained violin is hogging the spotlight from the cast as it overpowers its way to the foreground. It's almost as if they used a backing track as a placeholder until the actual score is inserted, but then said, "Ah, shit, we're over budget. Guess we'll just have to use what we've got." I would rather listen to any song on my worst song list than this movie score. Then there's this guy, Martin. Barry Keoghan plays the role of a 16-year-old kid for whom Colin Farrell has a rather odd relationship with. It's not immediately revealed why Stephen hangs around Martin so much, other than the fact that Martin's father was apparently killed in a car accident, so I guess he feels sorry for the kid. Well, except that's not the real reason at all. In fact, later on you find out Martin's father died during heart surgery being performed on him by Stephen. So now Martin wants to exact revenge, and he tells Stephen that his two children will get progressively more unhealthy until he makes the Sophie's choice and kills one of them. Yes, Stephen must sacrifice one of his children or else both will die. How does Martin have this power? What gives him this ability to control the health of others? Why doesn't Stephen just kill Martin instead? Who the fuck knows? This part of the story might have been more interesting if they could somehow explain the magical powers that Martin has or how he acquired them. It would also be nice if Martin didn't mumble and or talk too fast half the time. But this goes back to the bizarre cadence every character in this movie seems to have. There's also some random and extremely forced menstruation jokes and sexual innuendo in this film. But that's sadly the highlight of the movie. I know I'm actually in the minority regarding my opinion on this flick. It somehow gets a 79% from critics and 65% audience score on Rotten Tomatoes, which is far better than many of the other fecal factories that I've reviewed here. But it goes to show that if you put moving pictures in front of some people, they'll be entertained by it, I guess. Anyway, I won't reveal the end of this movie just in case you actually want to watch it, but let's just say it turned out like my senior prom. 2 hours of build-up, and then absolutely nothing. So there you go, the 10 worst movies I've ever seen. Since you'll be stuck indoors for a while, I suggest you avoid these. Unless you enjoy hate-watching stuff, then by all means, have at it. But don't say I didn't warn you.